You're listening to the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show on Spreaker.com, and I don't think.
Hey, welcome to another installment of the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show.
Boy, did that sound like a real radio show.
Yeah, don't jinx it.
Like a morning zoo radio show.
But anyway, we have a special guest with us today. We have Mr. Perry Richardson. Those of you who may or may not be aware of who Perry's credentials are.
Yeah.
He was with a band called Firehouse, most recently with Trace Adkins, and currently with Craig Morgan. And we're going to be talking with him later on.
Yeah, this is a big get for our show.
Yeah, it's going to leaps and bounds, guys, yeah. For the show here. So we have a lot of stuff to talk about here on this installment of the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show. And once again, welcome if you're listening. We've had people listen. What's the furthest point we've had people, like in Florida, call in? And,
Lower Archdale.
L.A.
Yeah, L.A. Steve Pullum in Galax, Virginia. And such as that.
Yeah, which Steve's still rideless in Seattle.
Such ilk as that. Yeah. We're men of similar ilk. I don't know what ilk is.
Yeah, I don't either. We're just making
stuff
up.
But it sounds delicious.
But we are here at an undisclosed location here in Thomasville at the Jack Shack Studios. And Brian, you had, we were off this week.
Yeah, we were off. I think we had to recharge our batteries.
What we were recharging?
Yeah, some of us are a little bit older than others. Some of us are damn near ancient. And we had to take some time off, even from practice, believe it or not.
I talked with Jimmy a lot this week.
Really?
Actually, four times in one day, actually.
Oh, okay. Jimmy's the Mick Mars of rock and roll around here.
Okay.
Speaking of Mick Mars, I saw him on a interview for, I think it was Good Morning America or something, and my God, he looks like he's been dead 12 years.
Yeah, I think he's been dead.
He is completely white. He looks like Nosferatu with
and
a black wig.
He always wears the hats that are way too big for him, and they come way down in his eyes. And
That's him. Yeah.
But Vince Neil just became a grandpapa.
A granddaddy.
Again, recently. I think this is his second go-around, I believe.
Me too. I mean, I had my first kid when I was 14. And the girl was like 26.
Oh, God.
And I don't know. It is what it is, you know.
Well, welcome again to the program. We've got some juicy tidbits coming at you. We have a special guest, Mr. Perry Richardson, again, formerly of Firehouse.
Yeah, maybe we should just...
Formerly of...
maybe we should just call Perry and do the interview.
We
can
do
him. Give the people what they want. Excuse me?
We could do that.
Yeah, you better rephrase that.
Let's see if we can get him on
Let's
the
Let's give it try number one and see what happens here. We can't really ever get a hold of Jimmy Henson. Maybe we can get a hold of Perry.
Perry is he is a rock star.
I'll do a little background music. While we're doing the call here. This guy has a nice wig. He's got a nice mop.
See who we can get on the line here.
Hello there.
Oh, my God. It's him.
We have a bona fide rock star on the phone with us.
Finally.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have the former bassist of rock band Firehouse.
Bassist extraordinaire.
And if you're not familiar with Firehouse, or, of course, Max Warrior from back in the day. He's most recently been with Trace Adkins and Mr. Craig Morgan. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr.
Time.
Perry Richardson.
Yay!
Hey.
Yay.
How's it going, my brother?
I'm doing great, man.
Good deal.
How's it going in North Carolina?
Well it's slow gin fizz here, baby.
Yeah. We got a little sleet.
I don't know what that means. I just made it up.
Yeah, it sounds good.
Yeah.
So how's the weather in Nashville? They're talking about rain and some sleet here in North Kakalaki.
Yeah, we got about the same. It's like it's been raining all day. I think it's got down to around 32 right now, so the front is starting to freeze up soon.
Well, once again, once again, if in case you're not aware, if you're just joining us, we're talking with Mr. Perry Richardson. Of course, he met a gentleman by the name of C.J. Snare in North Carolina, started a band called Max Warrior back in the mid-late 80s, right?
It was 81.
When they started?
Oh, wow, 81. 81,
yeah.
82,
yeah.
And
I guess it was, I mean, we might have been named something else before I came up with that brilliant idea to name it Max Warrior.
Mad Max.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah,
it was a Mad Max thing.
Yeah. Awesome. And you eventually, and you guys used to play, God, you would play, I mean, how many days a week would you guys be out on the road as Max Warrior?
We were out constantly. We only, I tell you what we did, we took off Christmas week, and that was it.
Yeah.
Wow.
We played 6 to 7 nights a week, year round, dude.
That's awesome.
I mean, it was crazy. And,
how was the money back then?
The money?
Yeah, right now, I mean, I can tell like 5 years ago, man, we made pretty decent playing every weekend. But now, boy, you can forget it. I mean, if you're lucky, if you can get a door gig nowadays. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, back then you could actually make a little money playing. I mean, we had a big 24-foot Ryder truck full of PA and lights.
Wow.
And we had, I think we had... Most of the time, we had about at least four or five guy crews.
That's cool.
We got so Dave's son.
You know, we were making $100 a week each, but we were.
Good. Nothing's changed. Nothing's changed
now
in 20 years.
What agency were you guys with back in the day?
Showtime.
Oh,
that's what I thought.
That was the big one.
Everybody, Sidewinder, everybody was with Showtime.
Yeah. Yeah, Showtime, that was a big deal. I mean, before them, I mean, we dealt with a few, I can't remember the names of those guys. There was this guy out of Atlanta that we dealt with, and I can't remember their names, but we dealt with Showtime probably about maybe 83.
Awesome.
I moved to North Carolina in 91. I mean, I'm a 43, so right when you guys were hitting, that was when, I mean, I remember seeing you guys with Poison, and I think it was Damn Yankees was in Charlotte, and I was so impressed, man, with the band, and I went out and rushed out and bought the album, and, oh, it was awesome, man. I was like, oh.
Awesome. Yeah, that was, what year was that? That was 93 or 4.
Sure. Well, yeah, I think I came out in North Carolina like 91, 92 when I got out of the service.
But the first tour we did was in 90 and 91, that was a Warrant Trickster tour.
Oh, I saw that too.
Yeah.
I saw you guys with Warrant.
Yeah, that was fun. And then the next one was Tesla.
Yeah.
That was like 92, 93, and then I think 94 was that Poison, Damn Yankees.
Now, who was your favorite band to go out on the road with?
Oh, man, Tesla was a blast.
Really?
I mean,
really?
They were fun to be around. Warrant was good guys, and Trickster, I love those boys too. I mean, we were lucky. And Slaughter, we did so many shows with Slaughter, and they had a big hand. And I mean, Mark and Dana pretty much recorded our demo that got us signed.
Oh, cool.
We saw Dana not too long ago playing with Vince Neil at Ziggy's.
Really?
Yeah.
We went out to LA and recorded that at Cherokee Studios out there with Dana and Mark produced it for us, and that was in 88. And,
I think I actually watched a YouTube concert of you guys last night. It was Firehouse and Trickster. And I was like, wow, man, you guys, the harmonies were like, God almighty, phenomenal. It was in Louisiana.
Really, you know, I was probably more into the vocal arrangements and all than I was bass, you know, playing bass.
Yeah.
I grew up singing and sang in a gospel quartet when I was a kid, and so I was into the harmony thing, and we concentrated a lot on that and worked hard on these vocals. But
well, you nailed it.
Yeah. You know,
it was awesome.
Yeah, it was fun.
Now you played with shortly after the Max Warrior run, you did a little stint with Nantucket, is that right?
Yes, I did.
Now, we have something in common. We've also opened up for Nantucket.
Well, he actually played with the guys. Was it 87 to 88?
Yeah, it was 80. I think it was like the end of 86, sometime around then.
Okay.
Max Sawyer broke up, and Larry Giselle called me, and I was with them a couple of years. I think it was through 87 and then through most of 88 before we decided to put the Firehouse thing together. So,
now,
yeah,
you,
it was fun, man. We had some times with Giselle, man. It was
now, you know who I spoke to not too long ago, just a couple of months ago, and I'm breaking my promise because I said I would stay in touch with him. You remember Joe Tronto?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I love Joe, man.
From down in Greenville at the Attic.
Yeah, he was one of my favorites.
Yeah, I was talking with him.
One of the best clubs we ever played, man. And he was always so good to us. And,
wow.
Yeah, and him and that guy, what's the guy's name, Myrtle Beach, Jim Griffith down there at Castaways. Those two guys
Castaways.
Were my favorite club owners of all time, bro.
Yeah.
Can you describe a little bit, okay, like after when you first put the Firehouse thing together and you're going out and you're playing gigs? Hello?
He's there.
Oh, okay, he's there. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Can you describe like the signing process? I mean, how did you guys know that something is getting ready to happen? For all us guys who are, you know, way past our prime. And how did you, I mean, was there something that happened to you or like, hey, man, we're getting ready to get signed? I mean, were you getting like local airplay or how did it happen?
Yeah, when the demo that we recorded with Mark and Dana.
Yeah.
Came back from L.A. with that, and we gave one song to, it was Home Is Where the Heart Is. We gave that song to a station in Charlotte.
Okay.
And to a station in Myrtle Beach. And it went to number one on both stations.
Wow.
I mean, they didn't, and it, you know, it wasn't like, it was just some call-ins and stuff. They were rating songs back then. So, you know, we were like, oh, that's great, but I thought it was mostly our friends calling.
Yeah, that's the only way we get a good crowd, so.
But it got a lot of interest from, back in those days, record labels had local promo guys in all areas of the country. I mean, there were guys that lived in Charlotte that worked for A&M and Capitol and Sony, and all those guys were in that area. So they were calling back to the label saying, oh, my God, we got this band in Charlotte that's not signed, and their song's number one on so-and-so station here. You need to check it out.
Yeah. Now, you're out of...
We did showcases for the... God... four or five major labels, and they all flew to Charlotte to see us. We never had to go to New York or LA or anything. It was crazy.
That's great. So how was it adjusting to that, going from living off of peanut butter sandwiches to
sardines
to you know, actually eating out at a restaurant?
Yeah, man, it was like a dream come true for us back then. I mean, I can remember the day that we signed the contract, flew to New York to sign anything, and I mean, I was almost crying sitting at the table. I mean, I'd worked so hard. We'd all sacrificed so much. And that's what we wanted to do, and it was finally coming true. And we were freaking out, you know. I mean, if it had ended the next day, I'd have been happy.
Oh,
my gosh, we got signed. That's what everybody wanted to do back in those days, was get a record deal, you know. It's maybe a little different now, but that was the goal of every band that was playing in the U.S. and look how many bands were out there. We beat the odds and actually got it done. You know, we were pretty happy. And, it all happens kind of gradually. You didn't one day you're eating peanut butter and jelly, and the next day you're at Morton's.
Jelly? You could afford jelly?
Food stamps.
It's a slow thing, and you gradually kind of comes in waves, and it's not a... I mean, sometimes you get slapped upside the face with something like, wow, we can do that? Yeah, you can do that now. But it was a great time in our lives. And I just feel so blessed and happy that I got to live through that, you know.
I mean, do you ever wake up in the morning, like when you have to, you know, get ready and go out and play on the road, and you go, oh, God, I got to get up, I got to go to work. And, you know, because most people, they go work in a glue factory or something like that, you know.
Excuse me? What kind of loser works at a glue factory?
I still pinch myself every day.
Really?
I lasted this long without having to get a real job.
God, that would be so sweet.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I'm still playing music for a living. It's like, you know, I mean, it's not rock. You know, it's country, but I tell you what, the country these days.
Yeah, it's the same.
It's a rock and country,
yeah.
There's
a lot of bands that are listening to country now. It's not really like my dad's country. It's pretty rock and stuff. So we have fun playing it. All the guys are so freaking talented. It's amazing in this town. And so I'm having a great time doing this, too. I just can't believe it. I'm still able to play music for a living. And, you know, it's great. Can't complain about anything.
Now, you guys, as Firehouse, you had a lot of stardom and success in the early 90s, would hit singles like Don't Treat Me Bad, Reach for the Sky, All She Wrote. You know, as far as, I don't know, I guess you might call them signature ballads or what have you. But but you guys won an American Music Award for, what was it, Favorite Heavy Metal Hard Rock New Artist or something like that? You beat out Nirvana.
Yeah, in 91. We beat Nirvana and Alice in Chains out for that.
That is so cool.
Can you believe that or not?
And you know, now, what? Now that was when Nirvana was on the cusp, I guess?
Yeah, they'd come out. I mean, they were just getting ready to explode. I mean, they were still pretty big, but
yeah,
obviously, I mean, that's a fan-based... the American Music Awards was a fan-voted award, so they really hadn't had time to, I mean, 3 months after that, they were, you know,
huge.
The biggest thing on earth. So,
how did the phone call go?
We timed that one just right.
How did that phone call go when they called you and said, man, you're not going to believe this, but you're nominated for the American Music Awards? You've got to be like, yeah, right.
We flipped out. We actually, Slaughter, I think, told us about that because they'd won it the year before.
Uh-huh.
And, they actually presented, there were presenters of the award that night.
Oh, no, that's cool. It was almost like passing of the torch, huh?
Yeah, it was great. Yeah, when they called our name, I almost turned inside out.
I don't know how to handle
something like
that. I
couldn't believe we beat those guys for that.
That's cool.
But, yeah, that was one of the highlights of my career. That's one of the times I got slapped up beside the head. I'm telling you, the biggest surprise. Surprise of my life, I guess.
So when you went out on your first tour, your first major tour, you said who was the first one you went out with?
It was Warrant. Sure.
Oh yeah, okay, Warrant. So I know you got some wild stories. Something had to. Did you have a Spinal Tap moment or anything like that on your first tour?
I mean, did you go to 11?
You know, you were nervous when you walked out and like, all those people were there. And
did you get lost backstage?
Trapped in a cocoon.
Yeah, trapped in a cocoon. Did you get trapped in a cocoon? You couldn't get out.
Hello?
Oh, well, we lost him.
We lost him. Better call him back. Yeah, he got scared of my
question. See, we were sitting here talking about Spinal Tap and see what happens.
We always enjoy each other more than we do our guests. We kind of... we like making each other laugh because nobody else laughs at us. That's behind our backs.
There you go.
See, we're talking about Spinal Tap and see what happens.
Yeah, see?
I got kicked off. Let's see, where were we?
Yeah, the question was, did you have any Spinal Tap moments when you went out on your first tour? You're like on the big stage now and people are there wearing your T-shirts and it's not at a club. It's like, you know... Did you have anything like, oh my God, you know, do we belong here? Are we supposed to be here? Or
we were flipping out on that when we first walked out on a stage to 20,000 people. You're like, oh
wow.
My God, this
yeah.
is crazy.
Yeah, I mean, how do
but
you
I
process?
Really, I don't remember anything really crazy happening. I mean, we've had some moments like weird things happen, but
yeah,
I mean, I thought it was the weirdest story that I can ever tell anybody. It's like, what's the craziest thing that's ever happened to you while you're on the road? We were in Indonesia.
Wow.
We were the first rock band to ever play in Indonesia. This was like 95 or 96.
Yeah, because you guys had a lot of success in the Asian, like Japan, Thailand, India, Malaysia, Singapore. You had a huge population.
It kept us going for a long time.
Wow.
But we showed up at a gig one day, and we got to fly to every gig in Indonesia, just all these bunch of islands. And we got to the gig, and none of the gear was set up. And I'm like, what's going on? Everybody's sitting around, all the local food guys.
Okay, somebody's fired!
What's going on? Well, it so happened that one of the local crew guys got eaten by a tiger.
Oh,
what?
My God.
Oh, my God.
While he was setting up our gear, and we're like, what?
Well, that beats our New Year's story.
He walked to the edge of the stage. A freaking tiger came out of the woods at the edge of the stage and pulled this guy into the woods and ate him.
Oh, my God.
Where were you playing on a back porch of a hut? Oh, my God.
Well, that's the best road story I've ever
Well, if it makes you feel any better, and I don't know why it would, but we had a guy die at one of our shows.
This past year.
Had a massive heart attack 5 minutes before we went. Yeah. And
we were supposed to start at 9:30, and he had a heart attack at 9 o'clock. So, needless to say, we didn't have... we had about six people there that
Of course,
night.
Everybody that's coming up to the venue, you know, to go in, they see all the cops, and they don't know what's going on. Was there a shooting, a stabbing? So they're like, let's go to the place down the road.
Yeah, and it was a door gig, so we drove all the way to Virginia in about 2 hours for $17 a piece, I think.
God.
But at least nobody got ate by a tiger. That's
no.
the best one I've ever heard.
That's the craziest story.
My God.
Okay.
Now, okay, like you won the American Music Awards. Firehouse is on fire. And
no pun.
And then around, yeah, exactly. And so around 1999, 2000, you decided you were going to do something different.
Yeah, I was kind of burnt out, and I'd been drinking too much and doing too many drugs and
hell yeah,
all that crap, and it was getting to me. And
Brian says he doesn't like cocaine; he just likes the way it smells.
You got that right.
Exactly. So, everybody in the band got tired of me, and I got tired of them, and decided to split ways for a while. And so I thought I'd move to Nashville. I always wanted to put a country band together. So,
oh my God,
I moved to Nashville in 01, and just somehow started. A buddy of mine that from Myrtle Beach that was playing drums for Craig. And
Craig, yeah.
Their bass player had to go somewhere one weekend, and they couldn't find a sub for him. They wanted to know if I could just sit in, maybe, and just kind of find my way through the songs. And I said, sure. And so I, halfway played some of the songs with him. And
Dave
Craig
does that every
it.
Weekend.
He said, hey, man, you want a gig? I said, yeah.
So hell yeah.
I played with him for 8.5 years.
Oh, wow.
Just left. I left and went and played with Trace Adkins for 2 years. They called me, and I couldn't turn down the money.
Yeah, that helps.
So after 2 years of that, even though it was good pay, I couldn't take that anymore, and asked Craig if I could come back. And they fired the bass player they had and brought me back in, and I was so thankful of that. And
I think
I love those guys so much. I mean, I shouldn't have left to start with, but it was...
Yeah.
It was a lot of cash, and I was just like, "Oh
yeah!" Even with a dead guy in the crowd, it's more than $17 at the door.
That's right. That's a lot of jelly sandwiches.
You kind of went back and forth between, as you said, you know, Craig Morton and Trace Adkins and Craig Morton. Now, what's the largest crowd you would say you played with? Let's say with Trace Adkins, for example.
Well, some of these festivals that we play, I mean, with Craig and Trace, I mean, we've played some of these festivals that draw like 40,000 people.
Good God.
You know.
There's I've met 40,000 people since I've been alive.
There's a picture on Perry's, on his Facebook page, and it's his cover picture, and it's like someone from behind where the band's playing. And you're on stage, you're standing on your little mat, your little rug, you got your set list taped down to your mat, and... there's just a sea of lighters in the crowd, and
that's
a lot of people.
It's crazy. I mean, Yeah, these festivals are huge, man, and they'll, you know, run for like 3 days. Some of them, there's one I think that draws even more people now. I can't remember. There's, I think it's one that we do up in, it's in the Midwest somewhere, that supposedly will have up to 80,000 people there sometimes.
Oh, wow. Like
a,
That's awesome.
A giant pack coming in. But,
wow.
You know, 20 to 30,000 isn't unusual at all for some of those big shows like that. So.
Yeah, that's kind of like what we do on the weekends.
Now, Firehouse.
We had 200 people on New Year's.
Having participated twice in the annual Rock Never Stops tour, were you involved with both of those?
I don't remember. I don't think I ever did a Rock Never Stops tour.
Okay.
I think that was after I left they started up.
Okay.
Maybe not.
It's estimated that Firehouse has sold over 7 million albums worldwide since your debut. And that's coming off the internet that I found that number.
I think that includes singles too, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, that's a lot. I mean,
yeah.
Not many singles are sold. I mean, Love of a Lifetime was the only single that really, I mean, Love of a Lifetime went gold. I think just the single went gold.
Now, the original lineup consisted of course, yourself on bass, CJ Snare, of course, the vocalist. Let's see, you had Bill Leverty, the drummer, Michael Foster, is that right?
Michael's the drummer and Bill played guitar.
Yeah. And of course, like I said, yourself, of course. And that lineup stayed current until you left, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, the other three guys are still there playing.
You know, from what I read somewhere, that they when you left, they replaced. They had a guy that filled your spot three times before. I think a guy named Alan McKenzie, I think, was given.
Alan does
in
a great
2004.
Job. He's been there probably 9 or 10 years at least.
Yeah,
they had a guy that was playing with Greg Allman, came in, and unfortunately something happened. He committed suicide, I think.
Oh, my God.
It was very terrible. And
my goodness.
Then they had a guy come in, Dario something. I can't remember. I think he'd played with Yngwie for a while. And something happened. He didn't last. And they found Alan, and he's been with them since then, so he's a good guy too.
So how did it feel when you saw them playing the songs that you had been there and recorded and helped write, and somebody else is up there playing?
I haven't really seen them play yet.
Wow, really?
I tried to get to the show that we.
That's the way it always is
with us.
Nashville.
They were playing in Nashville, and
they said, "Don't let that guy."
When I was with Trace. We had a gig in Nashville that night, just happened to be at the same night, and I got through at our gig, and I ran down, they were playing at the Wild Horse with Lawrence, and I ran down to see them, and when I walked in, they were hitting the last note, so I didn't get to see them.
Oh, wow, so you don't bump into each other at the Awful Waffle very much.
Yeah.
So we got to hang out for a while that night and catch up, but I really hadn't seen a play other than, you know, YouTube things, so.
But you guys still get along and everything? You still talk every now and then? Or?
Oh, yeah. Just,
that's cool.
I just flew up to Michael Foster's house about a month ago for a surprise birthday.
He makes it sound so like a not big deal. Oh, I just flew over to such and such's house. And, hopped on the jet and, you know, we...
It's not a private jet.
Yeah, I know.
It's by no means private.
You know,
I went to surprise him. He had no idea I was coming. That was awesome. I hadn't seen him in a few years. So, and Bill came by. I got to see Bill. CJ wasn't in town, but
yeah,
you know, I've seen CJ enough in the past. We're good.
We were
together a long time before Firehouse.
Right? Yeah, that's true.
Now you guys, a couple of years ago, you did the reunion for Max Warrior. And if I'm not mistaken, I think that was about the same time you were joining up with Trace Atkins. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. It was the same. I was busy learning all the songs for for Trace, and then I had to learn all the songs from Mike Sawyer and at the same time.
So you're playing Burning Down the Gates of Hell.
And Honky Tonk the Donkey Kong.
Hell yeah. Finally.
That's awesome.
Some
and
good
they
stuff.
Weren't really that different when you think about it.
Oh, my God.
And the thing is, it's probably the same chord progression, GCD. And
yeah, well, I'm trying to learn to play with a pick again because I hadn't played. I used to play with a pick all the time back, you know, through Max Ory and Firehouse. And then you move to Nashville, and that's a sin. You know, you have to play with the fingers here. So.
Right. Well, and, you know, I could never hang on to the damn thing. I kept dropping it.
Yeah.
Somebody saw me playing one night, and I was chunking, you know, on the strings, and they said, dude, I thought you didn't play with a pick. And I said, I don't on some songs when I need that attack. It looks like I'm holding a pick, but I'm using my fingernail on my first finger.
Oh, yeah.
And they go, really? And I go, yeah. And girls will come up to the stage, and they ask for our guitar player. They say, well, we want a pick. And then they come over to me, and they say, well, can we have a pick? And I go... And I hold out my four fingers, and I go, well, there you go.
Well, he tells him to pull his finger, and then I go,
pull my finger.
Yeah, that's the oldest trick in the book.
Yeah, that's Dave's signature thing.
Yeah, it's a signature move. But I got this, you know, I flip my guitar, my bass guitar over upside down, and on the back of my guitar it says, show me your tits. I swear to God, am I lying?
Yeah, that's what it says.
And they do.
Some of them we don't want to see, though, but yeah.
But yeah, you know, it's like that line in, if you ever watch Grumpier Old Men, there's a scene where they're in the grocery store, and Burgess Meredith is chasing the model, Sophia Loren, I think it is. And the lady that's playing her mother in the movie, he's chasing her around. And as Jack Lemmon and Walter Matthau are talking, here comes Burgess Meredith chasing her back. He goes, really, honestly, I'm a doctor. And Jack Lemmon looks at Walter Matthau. He says, I can't believe he's using that doctor routine again. And Walter Matthau looks at him and says, you got to go with what works.
Yeah, that's true.
I tell girls sometimes, I said, you know, I got this Lincoln. I got this 96 Lincoln big car. And
so we're rolling in the money here, too.
Yeah, in the money. And, I'll tell girls sometimes, I say, you know, I'm giving free mammograms in the back seat of my Lincoln outside. And they go, really?
Oh,
and this one girl told me, she says, what's your success rate for cancer? And I said, cancer? I'm just giving mammograms in the back seat. I know not what this cancer you speak of.
We call it the we call it the stinking Lincoln.
Yeah.
I want to see it.
Oh yeah, it's Suave de Boner, man.
It's a love machine.
Yeah, I call it the Pimp Blossom Special.
Oh my God.
So have you guys had a band vehicle or maybe a personal vehicle of yours that, you know, you went back and forth in gigs and everybody piled in and, you know, all the cool stuff happened in that vehicle?
Yeah, oh God, we had some. Yeah, Max Ory, when we first got together, we had a, I have no idea what year it was. It was probably like a 70s Winnebago.
Hell yeah.
I mean, we had, you know, 10 people in that thing, and then we had an old, God, I can't remember what kind of truck, some international.
Right.
Box truck.
Boy,
know,
if those cushions could talk.
When we first got together, we took that thing. I mean, our first gig, after we got an agent, you know, that we weren't doing like local stuff, our first gig was in Flagstaff, Arizona.
Wow. That's a drive.
We spent 3 months. We had an agent out of New York at that time when we first got together, and we spent 3 months on the road that first run we did from, I mean, all the way to Arizona and everything in between here and there. It was crazy, dude.
I bet.
Oh, God. Yeah, blew an engine in Tyler, Texas on the way out there.
Ooh, lucky engine.
Everything that you can imagine went wrong on that thing. It was crazy. So,
damn.
And we also, in Max Ory, we had a traded that thing in and got a four-door Dodge pickup with a camper on the back of it.
Hell yeah.
It was a tank, dude.
Kind of hard to take chicks back to the truck, right?
Did you make Scotty ride in the back?
Yeah, we put CJ was in the back most of the time.
CJ was in the back. Did he have anybody back there with him?
Yeah, couldn't drive. you wouldn't want to be in the truck.
Oh, I know somebody like that. Yeah, our guitar player, he
got a ticket.
He falls. I know he weaves a lot. And we went to a gig one time and in Virginia, and our drummer said, well, it's 93 miles to Virginia to the gig. He said, but we did an extra 17 miles on the way back from all Jimmy's weaving.
He likes to sleep on his way back while he's driving.
We'll be riding behind him, and he's in the truck, you know, pulling the trailer, and he's, like, all over the road. And we're like, dude, wake up, calling him on his cell phone. Wake up, man, wake up.
Oh, yeah. God. He's a mess.
Oh, my God.
Coming back from South Carolina. My drummer was riding with me, coming back from South Carolina. It had been raining, and he saw the reflection in the road or the lights hitting it, and he kept dozing off, and I was half asleep. I was taking five-hour energy drinks, and he just jumps up out of a dead sleep and as he looks into the road, and he goes, look out for that woman! And I was like, oh, my God. And he thought there was a woman in the road because of the reflection of the lights and the rain. And he scared the shit out of me.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
But
we've got a lot of those kind of stories.
God. So,
near misses on the road. Good God.
I know. I can't believe I haven't ended up in a ditch somewhere, or Jimmy hasn't ended up in a ditch. I pulled over many, many times in a lit-up area, and, you know, I always keep a blanket and a pillow in the back of my car.
Yeah.
Well, it serves a double purpose. But...
So the 280-pound lady's got a place to lay her head.
In case Brian needs a place to
lay
his head.
Right. what was it like? I'm a huge, huge Poison fan. What was it like when
huge
you guys...
What?
Poison fan.
Okay.
Brett Michaels and the boys. Were they pretty cool to hang out with?
You know, we didn't...
And
really
be honest,
were
they assholes?
Guys. We didn't hang with them too much, man. They were...
Over the top.
I hung more with the damn Yankees guys.
Oh, Ted Nugent?
Not Ted, no. Bro.
Oh, you hung out with Jack Blades.
I don't have a lot of good things to say about Ted. So,
okay.
Let's get the dirt here on our show.
He pulled a 9mm out of his pants and put it in my temple and cocked it one night.
What?
Yeah.
Wow.
It was loaded. So I don't. It has a whole lot.
That would probably put a damper on the relationship.
Yeah.
But the other guys were cool, but we didn't. All the other guys in the damn Yankees I loved to death.
Tommy Shaw.
Tommy's such a good guy. Jack, man.
Yeah.
I really love him.
I've always liked Jack Blades.
Talented, like good guy.
I saw him a couple years ago with Sticks.
You'd see him go in and off the bus every now and then. That's about it. They never went out and hung with us much.
Wow, that sucks.
Yeah. But,
what's your... I know you're probably like me. Somebody talks about the 80s, and you're like trying to access that cerebral cortex of your brain that just refuses to cooperate.
Well, that was the last era that I actually got laid, so I kind of like the 80s.
But I mean,
ladies were pretty good.
Now you, they were pretty good.
Do tell.
Now you guys played at a club in a town where I grew up in. You know, we talked about the Attic in Greenville. I used to go there a lot, and my band used to play there a bunch too. Oh, and another fellow comrade in arms, which I'm sure you know of. Of course, when I knew him, he played drums in a band called Lex Luthor, Sully Erna from Godsmack.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was playing, and I remember I used to go hang out with him and crowd, you know, when he wasn't playing, and we would take turns videoing each other's bands. Like, he would video our band, and then when they would go on, I'd video his band, and to this day, he still owes me a videotape, because I didn't have an extra tape. He's like, man, I'll just record us, man. I was like, well, I don't have another tape, but let me check my bag, and I had a recording of The Man with One Red Shoe with Tom Hanks, and I recorded over that. And then I said, just get my tape back to me. And, of course, he never did. The next thing I know, he's on the radio with Godsmack. Of course, that was many, many, many years later. And I'm like, that son of a bitch owes me a videotape. So
you never got over that?
That's so funny.
But
actually, we could used to we used to could record over other things. That's great.
Yeah, back in the day.
He actually
that's
did you a favor.
What is this technology you speak of?
Yeah, it was called put a piece of scotch tape over the.
He did you a favor by taping over that movie. Oh,
yeah, he did actually.
Yeah.
But you know, back in the day, you know, you see guys that kind of come and go, and but is there one person that kind of sticks out where you remember him saying, "Well, wow, that guy's really good. He's going to go places, or that band's going to do something one day." And
you're
then
looking at him,
and
pal.
Then they came up through the ranks, and maybe it took a little bit longer than maybe the other guys. But is there one particular group of guys or one person that really came out and you said, "Yeah, I knew that guy was going to make it."
Oh man,
you're looking at him.
No, I'm not.
I mean, a lot of bands back then. I was saying the other day that a lot of those bands that I would sneak into clubs to see when I was younger influenced me probably more than signed acts did, because I'd get to see them play and see the show and experience it.
Well, they were hungry back then.
And it was great.
I mean, literally, they were hungry.
They were hungry. But first time I saw, when I saw Wrathchild the first time.
Oh, love those guys. Shannon
and
Larkin.
I thought that was when we were all playing the same,
you
know, dive clubs, and I knew that something was going to happen with them. And Buster Brown was another band that was really good. That I know the singer went on to, I think he did a Bad Company. He sang for Bad Company for one of the albums.
Oh, okay,
a lot of those guys just ended up giving up, man, and. You know, not sticking it out.
Yeah.
There were so many talented bands back then. It was amazing.
I know. And it's that there's somebody right now as we're speaking that's sitting in a garage or basement, and they're just recording songs whether it be a band or an individual, and they're going to be the next big thing, you know. And I hate watching The Voice and American Idol because they concentrate on the one person.
Right.
The singer,
right.
And not the groups. Yeah. And there's a lot of great bands out there, and these guys stick together thick and thin, and they,
they work more for it. I mean, there's usually a single singer that's never been in a band, has never been on the road, and, you know, we had to sacrifice back in the day for it.
Oh,
and
nowadays,
that these guys get on these shows and just give them to them, that's what I don't like about that. But if they had one that had bands on it, a show like American Idol that was all bands. And
that would be cool, and they had to write a song every week.
Yeah,
and make them
do their own songs.
Exactly.
That would be awesome, dude. I mean, that would show.
I'm surprised somebody hasn't came up with that.
I know somebody's had to come up with the idea, but they probably went, oh, no, there's too many shows out there like that. But
too hard to put together.
Perry and I, like I said before, Perry used to come to the town with Max Warrior back in, I want to say, 84, 85, I guess. And you came and play at a club called Roadies. And I used to ride my bike down there and hang out and listen to the bands after school and listen to the band sound check. And one day somebody went, hey, grab this. And it's funny because sometimes you got paid at the end of the night, and sometimes you're standing there with your arms, hands out, and they go, here's a bumper sticker, here's a T-shirt, here's a pair of shorts, you know, and you're going, and, you know, they get you in on the wet side because you're underage. They get you in so you can drink for free, and you're like, okay, you know, whatever.
We get to see titties for free, T-shirts.
You know, like, you're over there hanging out with guys like Molly Hatchet and, you know, Nantucket and, Sidewinder and guys like that, and, you know, I was 16 years old, baby. And I was like, man, this is cool, man. But and my granddad, he always played music. He played guitar, and so I was always attracted to that side. I was the black sheep of the family. All my cousins and, you know, relatives out of seven kids and all the grandkids, I was the only musician.
He uses that term lightly.
I do use that term lightly. But yeah, but you know what you call a guy that hangs out with a bunch of musicians, don't you?
The singer.
A drummer.
Oh. Yeah. That's true.
Yeah, the Roadies was a great club, man. I remember always.
That was the day. It's the day when you could play all the time, man, and just, God, it just seemed.
Yeah.
I don't know what the money was like back then, but, I mean, what was your.
$100, remember?
I can't remember what we got paid back then, man.
And they say, here's a bumper sticker and a pair of shorts. And
I mean, we were getting paid enough to keep it on the road. You know, it was
Now,
a buddy of mine,
Danny O'Rourke, in the past handful of years, I'll say in the past 7 or 8 years or so, he finally got it. Because we were playing in our little, garage bands, and he would always go audition for bands like in Cary and Durham and Raleigh, and we lived in Goldsboro. And we were like, what's the matter, man? Why don't you play with us, man? Hang out with us, do a band. And he was always going to do that. And I really got to appreciate that because, starting a band from the ground up, that's a lot of work. But, of course, there's a lot of work joining a band that's already established, but that's a lot easier. You got to learn all that material. But his name was Danny O'Rourke, and he had another name he went by, but I always know him as Danny. But he played with Sidewinder for a while. Does that name ring a bell?
It does, yeah. I was going to say, I've heard that name. I can't remember.
There's a lot of people that grew up with me in Goldsboro, and I hear their names up here in the Triad around Winston-Salem and Greensboro. Like another one is a guy named Tony Rock, and I knew him back when he was Anthony Williams, And I'm like, Tony Rock, hey! So, it's funny to hear some of the names way up here. They still kind of reverberate. So, my hat's off to you guys like Tony Rock and people like that are still playing, and they're still trying to live the dream, yeah. And of course, like Perry, who stuck to his guns and like you said, didn't give up because you got to stick with your dream. And if something you want bad enough, then if you stick with it long enough, good's going to happen, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's ultimately, I mean, in those days, that's who made it, was who kept at it the longest.
Yeah.
There was a lot of people out there a lot more talented than we were and than I was, but they would, they couldn't deal with the road or they didn't want to be with
they just mom, didn't have the mane like you
had. They didn't have the hair.
Yeah, that's the big thing.
that was a big help.
Yeah. Now, were you ever with a bunch of guys that would do, like in the 80s, mid-late 80s, I hear stories like from Poison and bands like that, and glam bands, where they went through the hairspray and the makeup, just cases of that stuff. Were you ever in a band like that with I'm not going to point a finger at Firehouse, but, that band was out at that time.
Yeah, we went through...
Aquanet.
Bit of Aquanet.
There you go.
Yeah.
I never really used any makeup. I might put some eyeliner.
Right, there you go.
Maybe.
I think I did that New Year's Eve.
We go to play a Motley Crue song on stage, and Brian tears off a couple of pieces of black tape and comes and sticks them under my eyes while I'm playing. And people go,
perfect.
What is he doing? I'm like,
it looks awesome.
Yeah.
It looks like the Looks That Kill video.
Yeah.
It's more like the Licks That Kill.
Yeah. Because he's killing them. He's missing a couple here and
there. Well, every time if somebody misses a note, we always call them like a blind locksmith. Pick a key, any key.
Yeah, my God. We only mess up on the ones we've been doing for 20 years. We don't. The new ones we learn, we kick ass.
Exactly. You get tired of them. It's like, oh, God.
Well, Perry, thank you so much for calling in. I know you got better things to do besides
hang out with us.
On a Friday night. But
it was a pleasure, dude. I appreciate you guys.
Thank you, sir.
Well, we're just trying to keep music alive, man. Do our part, because it seems like, to quote Gene Simmons, he said rock and roll is dead. But we're just trying to keep it going.
Awesome. Well, you're doing a good job, and I get back to North Carolina. I'll lift you guys up.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah,
awesome.
That would be great. If you ever come to Ziggy's or, something like that, give us a shout. We'd love to come up and talk and hang out and say, hey, look at this guy.
Yeah.
we
knew him back then.
But we'd also love for you, before you go, maybe do a little shout-out for us promo-wise.
Sure.
The Dirty Overhaul Rock Show. That's the name. And we love you. Okay. Whenever you're ready, sir. This is professional.
Right. Hey, guys. This is Perry Richardson, and you're listening to the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show.
Wow. First take. He's a pro, man.
Forget about Brian talking over you while you're finishing up the end of it.
I was just so impressed. Everybody else messes it up.
Hey, let's have him do one more.
One more. I'm not talking.
All right. Hey, everybody. It's Perry Richardson from Firehouse, and you're listening to the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show.
Sweetness. That's awesome. Thank you, Mr. Perry Richardson. Ladies and gentlemen, listen out for Perry out on tour, I guess out on tour, right, with Craig Morgan? Going out. What kind of dates you got coming up?
We're our next show until the 30th. We're up in Michigan somewhere, but it's kind of slow right now. We'll start kicking in around March.
Well, okay. Ooh. When I look on your page and I start seeing some dates, I'll post them on our page, and so when people see that you're coming close around here, we'll be able to know what.
Yeah, if anybody wants to come out, it's craigmorgan.com. They got all shows on there. Come out their show and hunt me down. I'll be sitting by the bus smoking a cigar.
Yeah, big old fat stogie. Everybody knows, if you know Perry, if you don't have a bass in his hand, he's got a big old fat stogie in his hand. There's an awesome picture of him online smoking next to a no smoking sign. I love it.
Wikipedia.
So, Perry, thanks again so much, brother. We love you and the work that you're doing, and keep the fire going, my friend. And we'll be talking to you soon.
All right, brother. You'll be good.
Thanks, man.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Perry Richardson.
Wow, that was actually kind of professional.
That was very for us. It was. And so we're going to take a break, and let's probably just come back and just wrap it up.
Yeah, right? Wrap it up. Wrap that rascal.
That's right. So we will be right back.
And that'll be all she wrote.
That's right. So you are listening to a little bit of Firehouse and the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show. Thank you. Promotional consideration for the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show is brought to you by... Hey guys, Dirty Dave here from the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show. Do you have a tree that's just in your way and you need to get it removed? You got some branches hanging over some power lines. You got some tree stumps you need to get removed. Give Big Al and Sons Tree Service a call. They do stump grinding. They're fully insured, bonded. No job too big, no job too small. Free estimates and certified arborists. Give them a call at 336-225-4516. That's Big Al and Sons Tree Service in Thomasville, North Carolina. Be sure to give them a call and get those stumps, those branches, those limbs removed. They'll come in and they'll remove that tree for you and get it out of your way. And that's Big Al and Sons Tree Service, 336-225-4516. Make sure you tell them that the guys at the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show sent you. Hey guys, looking to get some new ink done, looking to get some sleeves? Give Blue Tattoos a call. Located at 1215 Winston Road in Lexington, North Carolina. You can give them a call at 336-224-2189. Blue Tattoos is a tattoo shop located in the growing city of Lexington, North Carolina. They accept cash, credit, debit cards with ID. You must be 18 or older to get a tattoo by law. They have tattoo artists working in their gallery who can do any kind of tattoo from black and gray to full color. They have a large selection of tattoo artwork, and you just can't find it anywhere else. They can draw something up for you. You can bring an idea in for yourself. They also have all types of piercings and dermals. They carry a large selection of jewelry for you to choose from. So make sure next time you want to get your ink on, call Blue Tattoos. That's B-L-O-O. At 336-224-2189. Look them up on the website at bluetattoos.com. Make sure you tell them the guys at the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show sent you. Well,
welcome back.
Song says it all.
It does say it all. And now that we are back from the experience of... Mr. Perry Richardson, of course, as we said before, with Firehouse, Trace Adkin, Craig Morgan, in the early days with Max Warrior. That was an awesome show. That's like my favorite show now. I mean, you know, because we've interviewed guys like Hugo from Tantric, and he was awesome, of course, those guys. But, wow, to talk to
Chris Leslie,
a legend.
From Fair Warning.
Yeah. Talk to Perry. That's awesome. Consider... You know, next time they come into town, we're just gonna have to sneak in the back door and say, "Hey, we're here. We're gonna hang out with you guys.
Remember us?"
So I think that's pretty much the end
of
this show.
Yeah.
We're done. We got nothing else. We're spent.
We can't do no better than that.
We shot our wad here. So thanks for tuning in. Tune in next week. We're gonna have some really awesome stuff next week for you too. This is the Dirty Overhaul Rock Show.
See ya. $1.50